and I will talk about the news of treatment of metastatic uveal melanoma. Well, with this slide, we are used to see this slide for skin melanoma or cutaneous melanoma. And when we talk about success in treatment of this disease, we don't remember that fatal year 2013. What happens in treatment of metastatic uveal melanoma? The situation has changed in the year 15, when for the first time there appeared the news about inhibitors of tyrosine kinase with xemelatinib. And this impacted the non-relapse survival, but not the overall survival. And in the year 17-18, the interest grew for the usage of checkpoint inhibitors. Take a look at this data. It's not the best result, both in non-relapse-free and overall survival, RFS. And now we have more and more studies on combined mode of immunotherapy. This is the basic option for patients with uveal melanoma with metastasis. And we achieve the overall survival of up to 19 months. And the breakthrough of this year is the appearance of new molecules in oncology in general, and in particular for the treatment of metastatic uveal melanoma. What do we know about the uveal melanoma today? Every patient after the treatment with ophthalmology is going to the oncologist due to the metastatic lesions. 90% have foci in liver. Nearly half is liver only, and some 43% is liver and other organs. Unfortunately, the fatality is determined by the following. The mortality of patients in the first year is up to 80%. What impacts this process? Well, we talk a lot about the molecular genetic markers. We understand that uveal melanoma is not cutaneous one, and it's different both clinically and from the point of molecular kinetics. There are four forecast classes from the low, intermediate, and high, and extremely high, with the development of metastasis in the first 3 years in 90% of patients, 90. I will omit the impact of the chromosome aberrations on this process and shall mention just the genetic markers, the predictors. If there's a low class of mutation in gene ERS and interim SFP31 and inactivation of gene PAP1 at high risk, all these parameters are now included in the guidelines of NCCN, and already nowadays, according to the we can forecast the risk of metastasis and follow such patients correctly. It's a kind of a breakthrough as well, not of this year, but at present, we need to consider this factor, and we should do our best to determine the molecular genetic clans. There's a class, there's a panel which is available, but only it has to be paid for. That's the test decision, and it's done in Russia as well, but at the expense of the patient, unfortunately, so far. So multi-year disputes on the impact of mutation in the gene GNA11 on how the metastasis will develop. So there's a positive outcome if there's a mutation in the gene. The gene Q209P. And this data was presented this year. That were interested in a mutant RUM and response to ICI, the presence of this mutation and the predictor of the response to immune therapy. The preclinical data presented that this type of mutation causes the production of neoantigen and thus may change the immune sensitivity of the tumor. On the slide, you can see the data of retrospective multicenter trial with 58 patients with mutations in the gene UFC3-1. 52% of patients had lesion of liver. Take a look at the time before metastasis developed, on average 6 years. Also, pay attention to this time, 26.7 months. Patients with uveal melanoma are to be followed up till the end of their life. There is no threshold when the metastasis may develop, and even this period of follow-up is not a limit for the uveal melanoma. Mutations are in 20-25% of patients. The mutation SF3B1, and the key point was the impact on the frequency or rate of objective response, ORR. Here is the clinical description of the patients with this mutation. Median survival was actually 4 years. 1 year survival made 94%. Pay attention to the fact how long the patients lived if they had no liver lesions. 6 years, if you compare it with 3 years of overall survival with lesions of liver. Take a look at the description of the patients that received immunotherapy. 34 patients were included, 33 were analyzed. Here you see interesting data, in particular the ORR was 29%. One patient received immunotherapy in a combined option, Manuel and Isipanop, and one patient who achieved a partial response received urocardial treatment. A median of overall survival was 28 months. Of course, these results are very promising, and perhaps the impact of mutation in the gene of UFC3B1 shall be regarded as a predictor, and future clinical trials shall be planned. Well, now about the breakthrough I've mentioned, the new molecular, intact molecular. It's the so-called B-specific molecule that bonds the T lymphocyte and tumor directly. This is the design of the trial or the study. The limitation is a certain HLA genotype, HLA 0201 to 201. It's only met in certain percentage of patients, and it's the basic criteria, predictor of sensitivity to this agent. Patients had to receive no therapy, and they were included with any LDG level. The trial was randomized, transfers 2-to-1, perpendicular with a weekly escalation of maximum dose up to 68 micrograms. A plateau was achieved at this dose. They were treated till the progression or development of toxicity. The other arm has the choice of the researcher. Well, the overall survival rate was the primary assessment, secondary assessment, time before the progression, and the frequency of objective response. On the slide, you can see the description of the patients. The groups were well balanced, and they were obtained the following results. So the ORR was 9%. In comparison, the group on comparison was in comparison with the researcher's choice group, that was 5%. One patient had a complete response, and 29% had partial response, stabilization of the disease, 37%. In comparison with the research choice drugs, that was 22%. Now, the main benefit of this agent, that is the impact on the overall survival, 21.7 months in comparison with 16 if the other drug was used, chosen by the researcher. That's really a breakthrough, and this data requires a future studies, and perhaps amitriptyline drug shall soon be registered, and of course we wait for it to appear in Russia to come, to be available. Since the data really, the results are really impressive. Subgroup analysis, we also observe the benefits of this agent. The metastatic lesions are to be detected as early as possible. It impacts the efficacy of tebentafusp. There was no relevant difference time before the progression, 3.3 months in comparison with 3 months in the research choice group of agents. That's the most interesting slide. Patients that had the progression, and there's a kind of a group analysis that shows the tebentafusp is better than all the other agents like carbazin, penibumab, and pembrolizumab. Now, we say that the patient who received tebentafusp and did progress still live longer than patients that did a different drug and progressed. That's the phenomena of this drug that should be studied in more detail. Now, about the treatment. When talking about treatment, we should always remember the adverse events, especially novel therapy adverse events. When we studied the study, and perhaps Svetlana will comment on me. We were very scared to use this agent. We participated in that clinical trial. We were scared about the adverse events on how the patients will tolerate. There were no registered deaths when treating with this drug, but 99% of patients had adverse events of grade 1 and 2, 45 of grade 3 and 4. Adverse events were as follows. They were, say, they depended on two pathogenetic factors, cytokine-mediated and skin-related. Mainly, we observed in patients the pyrexia development, chills, nausea, fatigue. That's due to the mechanism of action of the drug, cytotoxic lymphocyte. But take a look at this slide. Adverse events were leveled already by the 8th week. And in general, the patients tolerated therapy more or less okay at already a high dose of 68 micrograms. Now, take a look at the fact that uveal melanoma is causing the isolated liver lesion. We're now talking about the local general therapy, chemoperfusion in particular. Development of new filters caused a new trial, and the trial was called FOCUS. Its results were presented at ASCO this year. That's the randomized third phase trial, number 301. Initially, it was planned that there will be a subdivision into two groups, but unfortunately, the second group, or placebo, was never enrolled. So the continuation of that study was the study 301A with 59 patients. So they had transcutaneous chemoperfusion with melphalan, 3 milligram per kilo, 6 cycles, every 6-8 weeks. And we assessed the ORR. 79 patients were analyzed. Mind you, there were registered 6 complete responses, and in 20 patients, there were registered partial responses. in comparison with the group on the investigators' choice group. And 9 months and 3 months was the difference. A new filter enabled to minimize the adverse events. And in general, in 40% of our patients, they developed rather severe adverse events. This should be remembered. Valeria, mind your time limit. I'm sorry. Then I'll be brief. Really, I can talk for quite a while on this topic. Yeah, really, ASCO 2021 provided a lot of research. Now, let me briefly tell you about the chemoperfusion. This trial is a kind of a continuation of the previous one, combination of sevelamab and avelumab. And this trial is interesting, I believe. It's a new drug, de facto neighbor, new alternate method of treatment of uveal melanoma. And the impact on the activation passage. Statistical hypothesis is OR more than 21. More interesting study is combination of nivolumab and relatimab. That's the BMS new drug, new agent, LAG-3 blocker. An interesting hypothesis are that the ORR is in more than 20% of patients. Colleagues, thanks a lot for the attention. Sorry for taking too much time. I've mentioned it's a very topical issue. Patients are very severe, so I really want that efficient therapy we are discussing be available for treatment of patients.